Well, Robbie, great to see you again
Okay, after all these years.
in your hometown this time.
Yeah.
And happy birthday for last weekend.
Oh, thanks. January 8th.
Yeah, same as someone else.
Same as Elvis.
Elvis, did you guys ever meet?
No, we didn't actually. I wish I would have, but my wife met him.
Ah.
Yeah, my wife and John Densmore's wife were driving down the street one day, and this big blue Mercedes like cuts them off, right? And out jumps Elvis with the EP sunglasses and everything, and he says, "Hi, girls, you want to come to a party?" I said, "Yeah." So they did, and we were in the studio, so we couldn't come, but we heard some pretty good details.
I'll bet you did. Bet you did. Classic. It's hard to believe, but it's the 40th anniversary of LA Woman. How do you look back on it now?
It is hard to believe, because Ray and I still play those songs all the time, and seems like just yesterday.
Did it feel like an awesome album when you're in the studio? Did it have that feeling of, yeah, we're onto something here?
I think we did, because it felt like an album more than just a bunch of songs, for some reason. I think because we were very kind of relaxed the way we recorded it. We just put a bunch of recording gear in our little rehearsal studio. So wasn't in a real studio. But we got the good gear from, across street over at Elektra Records.
Yeah.
And that was a good way to do it because it felt more like a rehearsal situation than a recording.
Relaxed.
Yeah.
Is there actually an LA woman? Was that someone in particular?
LA is the woman. I don't think it's about a particular girl. You'd have to ask Jim because he wrote the song LA Woman, the words for it. But as far as I'm concerned, it talks about LA being like a woman, kind of very cool place to be with. And if you look at the San Diego Freeway, the 405, where it cuts off to the 10, it was actually designed by a woman, and it's very curvy, and it's like, so that works.
Wrote one of the biggest hits on the album, Love Her Madly. Tell me about writing it.
Love Her Madly was about my wife, Lynn, who we weren't married yet, but we used to have some pretty good arguments and fights. And whenever she'd get really mad, she would, on her way, she'd leave the house, and on the way out, she'd just slam the door so hard the whole house would shake, So as she's Don't you love her as she's walking out the door?
Don't you love her badly? Wanna be her daddy? Don't you love her face? Don't you love her as she's walking out the door? Like she did 1,000 times before.
You only got to tour it twice, though, two dates, is that right?
Yeah, exactly. It wasn't really a tour. It was just we only had time to play two dates before Jim left for Paris after the album. And that was too bad because it would have been nice to play some of those songs live.
So what was that last gig like?
You know, it was in New Orleans, and it was kind of sad. You know, Jim was just, I think the whole thing with the trial and everything that had been going on at the time really was getting to him, and he just had like no energy, you know. And it wasn't the greatest gig, to tell you the truth, for a last gig. So I try not to think about it, you know.
Yeah, Memphis woman, no, she smells so nice.
The treats about this new album is that there's a new song on it. And when I say new, it was recorded at the time of the rest of the album. Tell
right.
me about it.
Well, you know, Jim was really getting into the blues at the time, and he was always talking about, oh, we got to do more blues and this and that. And so we decided that one day in the studio we were going to devote to the blues. It was, okay, we're going to have a blues day, right? And I think what happened was that finally we're going to do the big blues day, and Jim didn't show up, so we had to cancel that day. But we did it the next day, and we recorded just a bunch of ad lib blues, and the new song is one of those songs. And the cool thing about it was that was the first time we heard him do this, the Mojo Horizon thing, and which we later he used in L.A. Woman.
Mr. Mojo Horizon. Mr. Mojo Horizon.
The other thing that's coming out too in this 40 years of the Doors year, is Mr. Mojo Rising, which is a story of the making of the album. How much stuff have you found? How much vision and so forth have you found of the making of the album?
Zero.
Okay. Must be a fascinating doco then.
Mojo Rising. It's actually interviews with Ray and John and I and Jack Holzman and Bruce Botnick and telling about the making of the album. You know, I wish we had film from the sessions, but unfortunately we do have lots of photos and stuff, and they'll be in there.
And you've got some film from around the time, there's bits and pieces, isn't there?
Sure.
Yeah.
But nothing of the actual session.
And was there any filming of those last two concerts?
I don't believe so. No. You know, maybe from, if you look on YouTube, there might be something, but...
Bootleg style.
Yeah, bootleg style. Mm. You know, if we only knew, we would have had 35 millimeter cameras at all times, like they do today. We didn't have the phone cameras.
Yeah, other people don't move a pace without filming it these days. It's incredible how much archival material bands are going to have in the future of themselves.
Oh my God, it's endless.
Let's just hope they've got the. Musical pedigree to warrant it, though. That's the tricky bit. You guys were in Australia, we worked out maybe around a decade ago with the Doors of the 21st Century. Did you enjoy getting out on the road with Ian Asprey and doing that?
Oh yeah, I loved Australia too. Always wanted to go there, and you know, I'm a golfer, so you know, there's a lot of legendary golf places down there.
What is it with all you rockers and golf? Alice Cooper plays golf. Why do you all love golf?
I don't know. You know, I used to play when I was a kid, and I actually knew Alice back then, before, you know, he became Alice Cooper. And we used to play golf all the time. I guess, you know, he was from Phoenix, Arizona, mm-hmm. which is a big golf town. But, you know, golf didn't become popular as far as musicians go until much later, and you know, a lot of the country guys were golfers, but you know, I think once Alice started playing, that kind of broke the ground for a lot of other guys.
Surrender to the waiting world.
I'd like to do a song that, or a piece of music that's just a pure expression of joy.
Jim passed away about 3 months after the album came out. If he hadn't, what did you see the band doing in the future?
That would be hard to say, but you know, we fully expected him to be back and to do another album. And in fact, when he was in Paris, we started rehearsing up some new songs, which ended up on the album that the three of us did called Other Voices. But I don't know. I mean, knowing Jim at the time, I'm sure it would have been real bluesy. You know, that was the direction. But you never know. It could have gone any which way. I'm sure it would have been good, though. You know, L.A. Woman was kind of a departure for us, and I think it definitely would have been fun.
How did you find out?
I was home in L.A. here, and I had a house at the beach, and got that telephone call, which I had kind of dreaded for years, you know, but never thought it would really happen. Mm. And, you know, I still didn't believe it, so we sent our manager at the time, Bill Sibbins, over to Paris to see what really happened. And then once he got there, he gave us the call and said, yeah, it's true, I'm afraid.
Are you satisfied still with the explanation?
Not really, but you know, I'm sure he's dead. I mean, that's the important part. How he died is going to be a mystery forever, I think. But you know, Jim wasn't in the best shape when he left. I remember he was like coughing up blood and stuff. You know, I'm sure he wasn't in the greatest the health, you know. So, you know, I'm sure a combination of two or three of the wrong drugs might have got him, you know.
You guys went over to Père Lachaise Cemetery, was it just last year?
Yeah, we've been there many times.
But there was a particular event just not long ago, last few months.
Yeah, last time Ray and I were in Paris, we went over there and lit some candles. And
Now, I've been a couple of times. It's quite a special place.
Yeah, it sure is.
It's got a special feeling about it.
Yeah, it's a beautiful place. And Jim loved it. He definitely wanted to be buried there. And, you know, so many of his heroes were there. And
Wilde and the gang.
Yeah, poets and artists, sculpture guys, and all kinds of artists. Mm.
Some talk sometimes that they want to move him out of there. Are you guys helping to keep him?
No, I mean, you know, they. I think there was a problem with the rent.
You know,
if you don't have enough money to buy a plot there, you rent one.
In perpetuity.
And you know, Pam at the time, I guess she didn't have the right amount of money.
Oh, right.
And they were talking about, you know, because so many kids would come and they would deface some of the other graves, and it was a problem. But then they realized that, hey, wait a minute, Jim Morrison is like the number three tourist attraction in Paris. You know, we better keep him here.
Yeah, might be a more sensible idea. Yeah. Val Kilmer was in Australia just about a month and a half ago, and I interviewed him.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, did you like the movie?
I did. I actually I worked on the movie as a you know, an advisor, and you know, I hung out with Val quite a bit. He really, really was into it, man. He had it down, I have to say. You know, when I first met him, I didn't think he looked anything like Jim. I couldn't understand how he could do the part. But he, more and more, he kind of became, he had the, you know, the wig and all that stuff. And boy, he really did a great job, I think. He should have got Academy Award. You know, there was problems with the movie, for sure. Didn't really tell didn't really show the proper interaction of the band and all that, but I think it's a rock and roll movie. It's great, probably one of the best ever.
Were you happy with the portrayal of you?
Well, what little there was of me. Yeah, I thought a guy named Frank Whaley played me. I thought he was great.
It's a weird thing to have someone play
you. Yeah,
it's great.
Very weird. But I think he captured the essence of me pretty well. And he had to learn to play guitar. I was teaching him for a couple of months. And the drummer, too, did a great job, I thought. Kevin Dillon.
Mm. Rolling Stones just put out their list of 100 greatest guitarists of all time. Yeah. I'm not happy with your ranking. You belong a lot higher up.
I think so, but, it's like a popularity contest, I think. I don't know who all voted. I think, luckily, I voted. Otherwise, I probably wouldn't have been in there at all.
Not at all. You would have got a lot of votes. It's 99 men and one woman.
Is that right?
Joni Mitchell's the only woman on that list.
Oh, my God, that's terrible.
Why can't women play guitar?
Well, there are some good players, but that's a good question. I don't know. It's the same with, why there's some good piano player gals, too, but not very many. I just saw this a video of Billie Holiday. Mm. I never even knew she played piano. She was great.
Like a fiend.
Unbelievable.
The three of you have just recorded a new song. And tell me about this Skrillex. It's sort of new for us down in Auckland.
Well, it was kind of new for us too, but, I've heard a lot about these, DJ guys, electronic musicians. And so the Grammy people wanted to do a thing where they put these remix guys together with other musicians. So they had some classical guys and they put them together with this guy, and then they had the rock band was us. And so we got together with this guy, Sonny, and it goes by the name of Skrillex. And he's just a kid from the valley who started putting his stuff out on the internet and, went viral. And he's a cool kid. And we played a song together. We went in the studio and put something together. And it sounded pretty cool, I thought, when we did it. But then, he did a whole remix on it or something, and he kind of made my guitar sound totally. You can't even tell it's a guitar. But apparently it's like number two in England right now, so it must be something good about it.
Brilliant.
Yeah. And he told me he plays it for the audiences when he plays his shows, and he says that's the one they all want. They love that song.
Well, Breaking a Sweat.
Breaking a Sweat.
Yeah. Awesome. Story continues.
Yeah.
Robby, thanks so much for your time today. It's been great to catch up with you in your hometown. Thank you very much.